रेड चिलीज, ग्रीन चिलीज, रेड कैप्सिकम, ग्रीन कैप्सिकम, येलो कैप्सिकम आर ऑल डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ पेपर्स एंड दे आर डिफरेंट बिकॉज ऑफ वेरिएशन. ब्लू बटरफ्लाइज, गोल्डन बटरफ्लाइज, ग्रीन बटरफ्लाइज, येलो बटरफ्लाइज एंड ब्लैक बटरफ्लाइज, पिंक बटरफ्लाइज, स्पॉटेड बटरफ्लाइज, यू द लिस्ट इज endless, and I am sure you can equally come up with so many examples of variation. And to show you the ultimate impact of variation, I am going to tell you a story. Let's go back to the time of the Industrial Revolution in England, sometime in the early 1800s. There is this little creature, Bistan Betularia typica, a beautiful name that will add some drama to this story. Commonly called a light-colored peppered moth. Mr. Moth hangs out on the tree trunks of England. The lichens on the trees blend with the color of its wings, keep lurking predators away from sighting it, and let it live a peaceful, uninterrupted life. But all of a sudden, things start getting really dark around here. With all the coal-powered factories spitting out soot into the air, the trees go from looking like this to looking like this. Mr. Moth has a distant cousin, Bistan Betularia carbonaria, who looks like this. Now, as time passes, Mr. Moth can see that there are more moths who look like his cousin than like him. At the start of the Industrial Revolution, only 2% of the moths were like Mr. Moth's cousin. But by 1895, it will be 95%. You would have guessed that since the lighter colored moths are not camouflaged by the trees anymore, they are more susceptible to be a nice dinner for predating birds. The black moths are more well hidden now and reproduce more often because they are eaten less often and have black baby moths, and all of a sudden there are very, very, very few moths like Mr. Moth. In fact, compared to 2% black moths in 1848, as I told you, it was 95% later on. This, my dear friends, is a typical example of phenotypic variation in a species and evolution through something called natural selection. So what is evolution? Evolution is the process of change in all forms of life over generations. And evolutionary biology is the study of how evolution actually happens. You might have heard of Charles Darwin, or Chucky Darwin, as he's known to his best buddies. He's credited as being the father of evolutionary biology. He's also the author of a very famous book, The Origin of Species. Lot of theories explain why species change over time, including mutation, migration, random changes in how frequently some alleles show up, genetic drift. But natural selection by far explains the most common cause and the most powerful reason for evolutionary change. He also put forth an important theory, the theory of natural selection, which allows some species to thrive and change the genetic makeup of populations over time, all because of the environment, how they adapt themselves to that environment. He went on a five-year cruise, not a cruise really, I'll say a scientific expedition or voyage, almost all over the place, all over the world, to observe different organisms. Now, in spite of suffering from seasickness, he diligently wrote down volumes of material on his findings and observations. And when he looked back on those journals, he hit upon some important ideas that helped him formulate his theories. He made important observations when he visited the geologically new set of islands, the Galapagos Islands. His observations and collections contributed to the inception of Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection. Maybe the most important of these were the variations Darwin observed in the finches in these Galapagos Islands. He studied over a dozen varieties of finches and observed that there were differences between them, and marked differences in the way the beaks were shaped in finches on the different islands. The beaks were adapted based on the type of food available in that island. So what did he observe? If there were hard seeds, the beaks were thick. If there were insects, the beaks were skinny and pointed. And if there were fruit with hard coverings, like, say, cactus fruit, then the beaks were hard so that it could puncture the fruit skin. This variation would show how the birds adapted themselves to superior variations based on the needs of the environment they were in. They increased their fitness, and this would form the crux of the theory of natural selection. So in order for natural selection to take place, a population should have variations, some of which are heritable, so that can be actually passed on from a parent to an offspring. Whichever variation makes the competition more competitive will stick, and this trait will stay and will be passed on to the future generations. Like with the case of Mr. Moth, environmental changes caused a variation of black-bodied moths to become superior, and soon these moths were able to survive better and reproduce better and go from 2% to 95%. Let's look at another example that can cause evolution due to variation. Let's assume a group of, say, red and blue beetles surviving on a bush and they're crawling around like this. Majority of the beetles are red and a small minority as a result of variation are blue and are hanging out on this side of the bush. Since they have food around them, they wouldn't move around too much. Now, all of a sudden, an elephant stamps on this bush and most of the red beetles get killed. In that case, only the blue ones would survive, and soon the entire bush would be filled with a majority of blue beetles, till maybe another variation came along and a beetle of another color would be produced. Now, this example also makes it very easy for me to explain a concept to you called genetic drift, which is kind of the opposite of variation. Now, opposite of variation is too terse or blunt a definition. Let me actually put this across better. Okay. Now, due to some reason, okay, if the resulting population is so small that there is a reduced scope for variation to happen, like in the case of this bush, we can say that genetic drift has happened. Now, due to some calamity, it can be the elephant stamping and wiping out the red beetles, or an earthquake that comes along and wipes out maybe the majority of the population that has the better genes, and the smaller surviving group starts reproducing and they slowly and slowly become the majority over there. Now, this is what we commonly call the bottleneck effect. Okay, bottleneck, when large population is suddenly and drastically reduced in size by some big event, the genetic variety will be very, very much reduced. As populations get smaller, there is a tendency for each generation to become more homozygous with lesser variety of alleles. Now, genetic drift is the name given to this loss of variation. It can affect evolution in surprisingly big ways, but only when the populations are quite small. Now, what small means here would vary depending on the organism. 50 individuals is small, 5,000 is big, 500 maybe. Again, it depends on the organism we're talking about. The basic mechanism of drift is that genetic variety is reduced by chance, making the individuals more similar to each other, and because of that, they will be more vulnerable. Infections and extreme climate events are frequent causes. Occasionally, invasions by more competitive species can be devastating. So just to simplify the whole thing, if I would just summarize the key points about genetic drift, what would that be? One, drift reduces genetic variation in populations, maybe reducing a population's ability to survive all these new selective pressures which the environment or surroundings have put on it. Now, cheetahs, for example, have very little variation. This species has reduced to a very small number at recent times. Because it lacks genetic variation, it is more in danger from various infectious diseases. Two, genetic drift acts faster, has more drastic results in smaller populations. Small populations usually become extinct. I'll give you an example. In 1800s, hunting reduced the northern elephant seal to just 20 individuals. Although the population has rebounded now, its genetic variability is much lesser than that of the southern elephant seal. Three, genetic drift may contribute to speciation, new word, that's formation of a new species, if at all this small group does survive. Now, groups that arrive on islands far from the mainland are also good examples for this. These groups, by virtue of their small size, cannot carry the full range of alleles which can be found in the parent population on the mainland. Now, it's obvious that what started out as a rare variation came to become a common characteristic in the population, especially in the case of the moths and the beetles. That's what we saw. Bottlenecking also occurs at times in human populations as a result of major epidemics like storms, earthquakes, and eruptions. An example of this occurred in the small Micronesian island of Pingelab in the Western Pacific. Let's look at this story. In 1775, a typhoon killed at least 90% of its people, eliminating most of the genetic variation at one shot. So one of the 20 survivors was a man called Nanbarki Mohan Sid. Mr. Nanbarki, please forgive me if I have terribly mispronounced your name. Now, he had achromatopsia, a very rare genetically inherited recessive eye condition that causes total color blindness and extreme sensitivity to light. Six generations later, nearly 5% of the island's population have achromatopsia. All of those who had it were descendants of Nanbarki. By comparison, only 0.00003% people in India or the US have it. Not only did these people experience a dramatically reduced genetic diversity as a result of the storm, but unfortunately that surviving gene pool contained the genes for this disease. Other words, the frequency of an inherited trait changes over generation. Since genes control traits, we can say that the frequency of certain genes in a population changed over generations. This is the basic essence of the idea of evolution. If you observe the cases of the beetles and the peppered moths, you can see some basic differences. What are they? In the case of the peppered moths, the black peppered moth became more common because of the survival advantage. Natural selection is driving the production of more black moths over light peppered moths. As in the case of the beetles, there is no survival advantage. It's just an accidental survival of one type of beetle that changed the common characteristic of the beetle population in the bush. It is not necessary that those who survived were the better variety of the two. Okay, I want to take this one step further. I have a bigger question for you. Now, there are a lot of beetles on that bush. It's getting too crowded. The amount of food per beetle starts reducing. As a result, what happens? Can you guess? The beetles are not getting as well nourished as before. So their average weight would obviously start to fall. And soon the offspring also get tinier and tinier. But is this inheritable? What do you think? This is a tricky question, right? If there is more food provided to the beetles now, will they continue to lose weight? Will they be thinner or... can they go back to what they originally were? The amount of weight they will put on will depend on the food available to them. So if the food supplies are replenished, then the beetles will start gaining weight again, even though a couple of generations of beetles were actually completely starved. Okay, so I took this example so that you can clearly see how organisms adapt themselves, how they inherit some traits, how they don't inherit others, and how to evolve through natural selection so that they produce more stronger, better, and future-ready offsprings. One more example of a trait that cannot be inherited. By the way, these are called acquired traits, okay? Acquired traits, because you get it during your lifetime, you don't inherit it. You remember the suntan twin? Of course you do. Her children would not carry her tan, right? Unless they went out in the sun themselves. Now, although their skin complexion would be influenced by her skin complexion, the complexion of the skin is inheritable, while tanning of the skin is acquired. I hope the difference is really, really clear. If you were to do a very cruel thing like cutting the tail of a mouse, do you think that the offspring of the mouse would have tails or not have tails? The answer is that they would have a tail, because when you cut off the tail, you did not mutate anything at the gene level. So this would not be carried down generation to generation. Mutation is an easy word. It just means a change of genes, not genes, genes. So this mutation or change can happen when the DNA in your cell is getting replicated, which happens like zillions and zillions of times every day. So a very, 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 very tiny error can cause a mutation. The opposite of natural selection will be artificial selection, where selective breeding will ensure that the desired traits are passed on. That's how you get grains of superior quality and how you get these two types of domesticated dogs to cuddle from scary werewolves. And this is also an example of what Mendel did with his pea plants. All the reasons how humans have, over more than 2,000 years, cultivated wild cabbage as a food plant and generated different vegetables from it by artificially selecting characteristics that they wanted to retain. So some farmers say wanted to select for very short distances between leaves and have bred the cabbage that we eat. Some have wanted to select for arrested flower development, and what did they get? They got broccoli. Or for sterile flowers and have made the cauliflower. And some have selected for swollen parts and come up with kohlrabi. And some have just simply looked for slightly larger leaves and have come up with a leafy vegetable called kale. Now, all of these have evolved from that single wild cabbage grandparent, and they are of the same species. But what if the variation gets so severe or intense that it becomes a new species? Let's look at that. Let's get into the process of speciation.